Hello students, myself Amrita Dhar, Assistant Professor of Electrical Engineering Department of Greater Kolkata College of Engineering and Management, GIS Group. Now, I will teach you switchgear and protection. In this video, I will discuss about fuse. This topic is included in Unit 2 Circuit Interacting Devices of the subject Switchgear and Protection. The course code of the EE/S5/SWGRP. So today I will discuss about basic fuse terminology, fuse element, rated current, fusing current, fusing factor, prospective current, cutoff current, arcing current, rupturing capacity, total operating time, and fuse characteristics. Now, what is fuse? A fuse is a short piece of metal inserted in the circuit which melts when excessive currents flow through it and thus break the circuit. The fuse element is generally made of material having low melting point and high conductivity and least deterioration due to oxidation. Now, it is inserted in series with the circuit to be protected. Under normal operating condition, the fuse element is at a temperature below its melting point. Therefore, it carries the normal current without overheating. Now, if a fault occur, a short circuit occur or an overload occur, the current through the fuse increases beyond its rated value. Now, this raises the temperature and fuse elements melts or blows out and disconnect the circuit protected by it. Now, in this way, a fuse protects the machine and equipment from damage due to excessive current. In this video, you can see that when a high current is applied on fuse, the fuse element blows out. Next is the desirable characteristics of fuse element. Now, the function of a fuse is to carry normal current without overheating. But when the current exceeds its normal value, it rapidly heats up to melting point and disconnects the circuit protected by it. Now, in order that it may perform this function satisfactorily, the fuse element should have some characteristics. What are the characteristics? First characteristics is low melting point, example tin and lead. Next one is high conductivity, example silver and copper. It's free from deterioration due to oxidation, example silver. Low cost, example lead, tin and copper. Now no material possesses all the characteristics. For instance, lead has low melting point, but it has high specific resistance and is liable to oxidation. Similarly, copper has a high conductivity and low cost, but oxidizes rapidly. Therefore, a compromise is made in the selection of material for a fuse. So, what are the materials generally used for the fuse wires? The most commonly used materials for the fuse elements are lead, tin, copper, silver, zinc and aluminium. In this picture you can see that melting point and specific resistance of each of the material. Now, for a small current up to 10 ampere, tin or an alloy of lead and tin, lead is 37% and tin is 63%, now is used for making the fuse element. But for the larger current, copper or silver is employed. So it's usual practice to tin the copper to protect it from oxidation. Now, zinc is good if a fuse with considerable time lag is required. That is one which does not melt very quickly with a small overload. Now, the present trend is to use silver despite its high cost due to these reasons. Okay, first one is it is comparatively free from oxidation. It does not deteriorate when used in dry air. The coefficient of expansion is so small that no critical fatigue occurs. Therefore, the fuse element can carry the rated current continuously for a long time. Next, the conductivity of silver is very high. Therefore, for a given rating of fuse element, the mass of silver metal required is smaller than that of the other materials. And this minimizes the problem of clearing the mass of vaporized materials set free on fusion and thus permits fast operating speed. Next one, due to comparatively low specific heat. Now, due to comparatively low specific heat, silver fusible elements can be raised from normal temperature to vaporization quicker than other fusible elements. Moreover, the resistance of silver increases abruptly as the melting temperature is reached, thus making the transition from melting to vaporization almost instantaneously, so the operation becomes very fast at higher currents. Now, last one is silver vaporizes at a temperature much lower than the one at which its vapor will readily ionize. So, when an arc is formed through the vaporized portion of the element, the arc path has high resistance. As a result, short circuit current is quickly interrupted. Next one is the characteristics of fuse. So, time required to blow out the fuse depends on the magnitude of the excessive currents. The greater the current, the smaller the is the time taken by the fuse to blow out. So, it has a inverse characteristics. If current is large, time is small, and if current is small, then time is high. So, fuse has a inverse characteristics. Because a large current can significant damage in the system, so we have to clear the faulty section as early as possible. That's why fuse has a inverse time characteristics. Now, what are the advantages of using fuse? Now, the first advantage is it is the cheapest form of protection available. It requires no maintenance. Now, its operation is inherently completely automatic, unlike a circuit breaker, which requires an elaborate equipment for automatic action. Next one is it can break heavy short circuit current without noise or smoke. The smaller size of fuse impose a current limiting effect under short circuit conditions. Next one, inverse time characteristics. The inverse time characteristics of a fuse makes it suitable for overcurrent protection. And the last one is the minimum time of operation can be made much shorter than with the circuit breaker, but it has several disadvantages. The first disadvantage is considerably time is lost in rewiring or replacing a fuse after operation. Now, that whenever a overload or a short circuit occurs, we have to replace the fuse materials. So, it's really a problem. Now, second one on heavy short circuit, discrimination between fuse in series cannot be obtained unless there is sufficient difference in the size of the fuse concerned. And the last one, the current time characteristics of a fuse cannot always be correlated with that of the protected apparatus. Now, sometimes we need instantaneous disconnecting device, but fuse has a inverse characteristics. So, for a small current, it took large time. Next, I will describe some important terms related to fuse. First one is the current rating of fuse elements. Now, what is it? It is the current which the fuse can normally carry without overheating or melting. It depends upon the temperature rise of the contacts of fuse holder, fuse material and the surrounding of the fuse. So, this is the normal operating current of fuse element. Next one, fusing current. It is the minimum current at which the fuse element melts and thus disconnects the circuit protected by it. Now, obviously, its value will be more than the current rating of the fuse elements. Otherwise, under normal operating condition, the fuse elements melts and disconnects the circuit. Now, for a round wire, the approximate relation between fusing current and diameter is fusing current is equal to K into D to the power 3 by 2, where D is the diameter of the wire and K is a constant. Now, K is known as the fusing constant. So, what is the formula? Fusing current is equal to K into D to the power 3 by 2, where D is the diameter of the wire and K is the fuse constant. Now, it's the value of K, it depends upon the metal of which the fuse element is made. Now, Sir W.H. Preece found the value of K for different materials. For copper, the value of K is 2530 if diameter is in centimeter, and the value of K is 80 if the diameter is in millimeter. Similarly, the value of K for aluminium is 1873 when D is in centimeter and 59 when diameter is in millimeter. The value of K for tin is 405.5 when the diameter is in centimeter. Value of K for tin is 12.8 when D is in millimeter, and the value of K for lead is 340.6 when diameter is in centimeter and 10.8 when the diameter is in millimeter. The fusing current depends upon the various factors. First, material of the fuse element. Next, length. Smaller the length, the greater the current, because a short fuse can easily conduct away all the heat. Next, fusing current depends on diameter, size, location of the terminals, its previous history and type of enclosure used. Next one, the fusing factor. Now, it is the ratio of minimum fusing current to the current rating of the fuse element. That is, fusing factor is minimum fusing current by current rating of fuse. So, what is fusing current? Fusing current is the minimum current at which fuse elements melts. And what is the current rating of the fuse elements? It is the current which the fuse element can normally carry without overheating or melting. So, the ratio between fusing current, minimum fusing current and current rating of the fuse, that means the normal operating current of fuse is known as the fusing factor. Now its value is always more than 1. The smaller the fusing factor, the greater is the difficulty in avoiding deterioration due to overheating and oxidation at rated current, carrying current. Now for a semi enclosed or rearrangeable fuse which employs copper wire as the fuse element, the fusing factor is usually 2. Lower the values of fusing factor can be employed for enclosed type cartridge fuse using silver or bimetallic elements. Next is the prospective current. It is the RMS value of the first loop of the fault current obtained if the fuse is replaced by an ordinary conductor of negligible resistance. I repeat, it is the RMS value of the first loop of the fault current obtained if the fuse is replaced by an ordinary conductor of negligible resistance. So in this figure, how AC current is cut up by a fuse. The fault current would normally have a very large first loop, but it actually generates sufficient energy to melt the fusible element well before the peak of this first loop is reached. Next one is the cutoff current. Now it is the maximum value of fault current actually reached before the fuse melts. It is maximum value of fault current actually reached before the fuse melts. Now, on the occurrence of a fault, the fault current has a very large first loop due to a fair degree of asymmetry. Now, the heat generated is sufficient to melt the fuse element well before the peak of the first loop is reached. Now the current corresponding to this point is the cutoff current. Now the cutoff current depends on current rating of the fuse, value of the prospective current and asymmetry of the short circuit current. That the outstanding feature of fuse action is the breaking of circuit breaker before the fault current reaches its first peak. Now this gives the fuse a great advantage over the circuit breaker. Now I would like to mention that outstanding feature of fuse action is the breaking of circuit breaker before the fault current reaches its first peak. And this gives the fuse a great advantage over the circuit breaker, since most severe thermal and electromagnetic effects of short circuit currents are not experienced with fuse. So the circuits protected by fuse can be designed to withstand maximum current equal to the cutoff value. Now this consideration together with the relative cheapness of fuse allows much saving in the cost. Next one is the pre-arcing time. It is the time between commencement of fault and the instant when cutoff occurs. So at this point cutoff occurs. So it is the time between commencement of fault and the instant when the cut occurs. Now pre-arcing time is generally 0.001 seconds. Now when a fault occurs, the fault current rises rapidly and generates heat in the fuse element. Now as the fault current reaches the cutoff value, the fuse element melts and the arc is initiated. The time from the start of the fault to the instant that the arc is initiated is known as the pre-arcing time. Here the cutoff is occurred. So pre-arcing time is the time gap between commencement of the fault and the instant when cutoff occurs. Now, its typical value is 0.001 second. Is very small. Next one is the arcing time. This is the time between the end of pre-arcing time and the instant when the arc is extinguished. At this point, the current is zero and arc is finished. So this is the time between the end of the pre-arcing time and the instant when the arc is extinguished. So this is our arcing time and this is the pre-arcing time. So what is the total operating time? Total operating time is the sum of pre-arcing time and arcing time. That means this is the total operating time. Now it may be noted that operating time of a fuse generally quite low as compared to the circuit breaker. Now this is added an advantage of fuse over a circuit breaker. A fuse in series with a circuit breaker of low breaking capacity is a useful and economical arrangement to provide adequate short circuit protection. Now it is because the fuse will blow under fault condition before the circuit breaker has to operate. The last one is the breaking capacity. It is the RMS value of AC component of maximum prospective current that a fuse can deal with at a rated service voltage. Okay. Next, current carrying capacity of fuse element. The current carrying capacity of a fuse element mainly depends on the metal used and the cross-sectional area. But it is affected also by length, the state of surface and the surroundings of the fuse. Now, when the fuse element attains steady state temperature, we can write heat produced per second equals to heat lost per second by convection or radiation or conduction. Okay. Now, heat produced per second is equal to I square R. Now I square R equals to constant into effective surface area. Now write the formula of R, rho L by A. So I square rho L by A equals to constant into D into L, that is the effective surface area, where D is the diameter of the fuse element and L is the length of the fuse element. Next, break this area into pi by 4 d square. So, the L and L are cancel out and we get I square equals to constant into d cube. Because here rho is a constant, pi by 4 is a constant term. So, I square is proportional to d cube. That is known as fuse law. Current square equals to the diameter cube root of diameter. Next one is a problem. A fuse wire of circular cross section has a radius of 0.8 mm. The wire blows off at a current 8 ampere. Calculate the radius of the wire that will blow off at a current of 1 ampere. Now, if I square is proportional to D cube, then I square is also proportional to R cube, where R is the radius. Now, I2 by I1 whole square equals to, we can write R2 by R1 whole cube. Now, we can write R2 equals to R1 into I2 by I1 whole to the power 2 by 3. What is the value of R1? R1 is 0.8. What is the value of I1? I1 is 8 ampere. And what is the new value of current? That is 1 ampere. So I2 is 1 ampere. By putting the value of I2 and I1, we get the value of R2 is 0.2 mm. So what is the radius of the wire that will blow off at a current 1 ampere? the radius is 0.2 mm. That's all from today's class. If you have any problem, please contact with me. My contact details is given on the first slide. Thank you.